Question number one, the Honourable Tony Ryall.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. To the Minister of Health, does he expect the health sector to follow the Auditor General's procurement guidelines that advise that a public entity should ensure that any information given to one tenderer that could significantly affect its understanding of the procurement is also conveyed to all other tenderers and treat all tenderers in a fair and equitable manner? And is he satisfied that the tenderers were treated fairly in the community services contract at the Hawkes Bay District Health Board?
The Honourable David Cunliffe.
Madam Speaker, yes, and I imagine that that is a matter currently under review by the Director General's Independence Governance Report Panel.
Supplementary question, the Honourable Tony Ryall.
Has he yet read the email of the 10th of May 2005 tabled yesterday, which shows Chief Executive Chris Clark instructed staff to send Mr Houseman draft tender documents some weeks before the tender process opened and before any other party, and is this acceptable behaviour?
The Honourable David Cunliffe.
Madam Speaker, I repeat that that is a matter that is likely to be under review by the Director General's Independent Governance Review Panel.
Supplementary question, Russell Fairbrother.
Supplementary, the Minister asks, is it the Minister's view that contracts over $100,000 should go to tender, and can he provide any examples of where that did not occur?
The Honourable David Cunliffe.
Madam Speaker, yes. I was disturbed to be advised that the Hawke's Bay DHB negotiated a contract with Royston Hospital against legal and management advice and chose to award a $600,000 contract without tender. I was further concerned to learn that minutes were subsequently changed by the former chairman against legal advice, and that a former board member who had a clear conflict of interest took part in discussions regarding this contract, and that a former board member had not properly declared his interest.
Supplementary.
Madam Speaker, I am also aware of an allegation that involved the chair being involved in negotiations of a laboratory contract that was subsequently set aside by the Commerce Commission and was later awarded to another provider.
Supplementary question, Barbara Stewart.
Thank you.
Order, Barbara Stewart.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. Is he acting to ensure that this time and money-wasting deviation from tendering guidelines cannot be repeated by any other district health board, and if not, why not?
The Honourable David Cunliffe.
Madam Speaker, the purpose of acting as I have done is in part to prevent the further wastage of public money as has been spent on legal and understand public relations firms in relation to the shambles at the Hawke's Bay District Health Board. I imagine that all DHBs, while there is no similar situation that I'm aware of, will have great cognizance of these events and take care henceforth.
Supplementary question, Sue Ketchley.
Did the Hawke's Bay District Health Board have in place a conflicts of interest register? And were all board members required to declare any potential conflict of interest at the start of every board meeting, as other DHBs require board members to do? If so, does he believe the alleged conflicts of interest around the tendering of contracts at the Hawke's Bay DHB were a result of gross negligence or some worse offence?
The Honourable David Cunliffe.
Yes, it is standard practice for DHBs to maintain a conflicts of interest register, and the Hawke's Bay DHB in principle did so. However, it appears that not all board members had at least kept their entries current and up to date, because in the case of Royston Hospital, at least one member of the board had not listed their interests in Royston on that register. Madam Speaker, the Office of the Auditor General was also very critical of the Hawke's Bay DHB for what it considered a lack of detail and rigour in its conflict management policy.
Supplementary question, the Honourable Tony Ryall.
How can the Minister stand in the House and say that every tenderer was treated fairly when the email of the 24th of May 2005 tabled yesterday, in which Mr Houseman received the confidential draft documents, proposed changes to benefit his company, a preference offered to no other tenderer in the process, And is that what he would expect of someone about to be appointed to that very district health board?
The Honourable David Cunliffe.
Madam Speaker, perhaps the member did not hear my earlier answer, but I have not taken a position on the question of fact to which he refers. I said yes, Mr Ryall, to the principal, and I referred the matter of fact to the Director General.
Supplementary question, the Honourable Tony Ryall.
Why did he answer a second yes to the primary question, referring to whether all tenderers were being treated fairly? And does it show that he has yet to read the 27th of May 2005 email tabled yesterday, recovered by forensic analysis in London, which the Chief Executive agreed to alter the tender documents on the terms proposed by Mr Houseman at a time when no other potential bidder had the opportunity? And is that consistent with the Auditor General's guidelines?
The Honourable David Cunliffe.
Madam Speaker, that question comes in two parts. Let me deal with them separately. In respect of the question about the two yeses, I note that there are two questions of principle in the primary question, and the yeses applied respectively to each of them. In respect of the second part of the question, that is a matter for the Director General's review report, which I look forward to now that the injunction which was sought by Chairman Atkinson and his board has been lifted by the Commissioner.
Supplementary question, the Honourable Tony Ryall.
I'm aware that in May 2005, when Mr Houseman's appointment was going through the Cabinet process, he was colluding with the Chief Executive through emails to get favourable conditions in the tender document. And is this what the Minister agreed to as managing any conflict of interest?
The Honourable David Cunliffe.
I note that the member opposite is not quite so courageous about the use of words like colluding outside the House.
Supplementary question.
Oh, that's got me worried.
Order. The Honourable Tony Ryall. Point of order, Rodney Hyde.
It's against standing orders to suggest that a member lacks courage. And I think when that's given as just the answer to a supplementary question, it certainly can't be addressing the question.
Well, perhaps the Minister would like to add to his answer in a way that's consistent with the standing orders.
Yes, Madam Speaker, I think it is interesting that the member has not cared to repeat similar language outside the House.
Supplementary question. The Honourable Tony Ryall.
Is he aware that 9 months earlier, Mr Houseman had met with senior ministers Cullen, King, Dyson and Swain for a briefing on the home support sector? And since the scale of Mr Houseman's involvement in the health sector would have been made clear, did any of these ministers express concern at the appointment of Mr Houseman to the Hawke's Bay District Health Board at a time when his company wanted to tender for multi-million dollar contracts with that very same District Health Board?